It's with a heavy heart that I woke up this morning and found that there was yet another mass murder in Buffalo, New York, yesterday. And we have prayed so hard for the cessation of senseless killings such as this. Let us keep the families and those that have been devastated by this tragedy in mind. And as it happens, I believe our introit hymn is appropriate to this matter. It is "Help Us Accept Each Other." It is number 560 in the Methodist. Church and our worship service for Southeastern Dutchess Cooperative Parish for the fifth Sunday of Easter. And it's good to be with you all. Good to see you all from on our Zoom connections, all of you from New York and Missouri and North Carolina and points west. Thank you, brothers and sisters. Let us now continue in worship. And join me in the call to worship, which is found in your bulletin. Come, all who are weary of wealth, of poverty, of power, of struggle, of division.
Come, all who are heavy laden, with too much, with too little, with anxiety, with fear, with anger.
Come, all who have hope for liberation, for peace, for freedom, for the kingdom.
Hear his words, sooner I am making all things new. Come, let's worship the Lord who is making all things new.
Let's sing the opening hymn for the healing of the nations, number 428. Join me in our opening prayers. Loving and merciful One, we thank you for the community in which you have placed us, for the brothers and sisters with whom we walk this pilgrim journey. Yet we confess that we often fail to love as you love. We push aside those whom we believe are the least in your kingdom. We fail to see your kingdom in Scripture, because we fail to see your kingdom in each other. Form in us a new vision of community, in which there is neither east nor west, neither south nor north. We pray for the sake of your kingdom, that both is and is yet to come. Amen.
The New Testament lesson for today is Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life.
Today's gospel lesson is from John chapter 13. Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. When he had gone out, Jesus said, now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
Reading today came from John 13, and it was a relatively short tag on. It's the very end of the chapter, and as I looked at the rest of the chapter, I realized that the first part of John 13 is traditionally done on certain services that are conducted on Maundy Thursday or Holy Thursday right before Easter. And one of the reasons why is that the beginning of chapter 13, to which Jesus is giving his moral, that you heard Mark read, is about the Passover supper that Jesus had with his disciples, where he washes their feet. And some of you may recall that in past Maundy Thursday services, some churches would have either foot washing or hand washing to commemorate that act by Jesus of humbling himself before his what were students, his disciples who he was teaching, by doing something that only the lowliest of servants did back in those days. Now, I think we all can recall, you know, that back 2,000 years ago in the Middle East, where Christ had his ministry, it was hot, it was dry, it was dusty. There weren't any asphalt roads or concrete sidewalks. People were walking in dirt, you know, and they wore sandals. They wore simple air-conditioned footgear. And their feet got dirty all the time. And so it was the custom, if you will, in houses that had servants, that the master and the family would come in and they would have their feet washed by one of the servants. So at the Passover supper in John 13, when Jesus starts to do this washing of feet, his apostles were kind of beside themselves, and they started to say, no, you can't do this, you know. I mean, I should be washing your feet and so forth. But nevertheless, Jesus continues. He had taken off his exterior robe. He had taken a towel and wrapped it around his shoulder, and he took a bowl of water and began to go around and wash the feet of his students, his disciples, one at a time, and then he would wipe them off with the towel. And he even spent time with Judas Iscariot, who Jesus knew was going to betray him not too long after that. But he showed his love and care by serving them with the most menial of tasks, washing their feet. And it's surprising that the greatest humanitarian, probably the most famous person to ever walk this earth, would humble himself in front of these young people that he was teaching about God's love. It's quite a lesson. Why did he do it? Well, you know, it reminded me about an old Chinese proverb that you probably have heard before. It goes, tell me and I'll forget. Show me and I'll remember. But involve me and I'll understand. Tell me and I'll forget. Show me and I might remember, but involve me and I'll understand. Involvement. Jesus was making a point to his disciples by being involved and involving them. Involvement, when you do something and are actively engaged in something, all of your senses, not just your sight or your hearing are involved, but your whole body, your movement, the sense of touch, maybe the sense of smell, motions of your muscles and so forth. You're involved, and when you do those kinds of things, it's like practice, 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 right? You start to really understand and absorb this. So in John 13, Jesus is not only demonstrating this, but he's involving them. They feel his touch. And he's teaching them the bottom line of the gospel punchline, if you will, that we heard read this morning. And that is, love one another as I have loved you. I loved you even to the point where I washed your dirty feet, which was a job for the lowest. He is demonstrating the power of God's love. And he wants to express this love to each and every one of them, even Judas, even the one who would betray him. And Judas is treated no differently from all the others present there. He shows his love for them by washing their dirty feet. Jesus is directing and commanding us by this act to be faithful stewards of the gifts that God has given to each and every one of us. And to do that, he's commanding us to be humble servants as we share those gifts with one another. We need to be humble servants in the places where we live, the places where we work and play. He's directing us from time to time to make willing sacrifices to help by serving even as a parent. Many of us are parents here. We know what that kind of giving and serving of children feels like. And Some of us have been in parenting-like professions or situations. We've been teachers and nurses and caregivers and so forth. We know that feeling of doing for children or doing for others that need us at that time. We are serving them. Jesus wants to live that kind of a serving life because God will give us a spiritual power to live with, to share the love that he has for all of creation, for everyone. And by doing that, then we become the best servant we can possibly be. Now, the idea of service and serving one another is not new, and it's certainly not restricted to what church people do. It has been an active part of culture for a long time. Service to our community, service to one another in our religious institutions, our educational institutions. Serving others is truly a Christian ideal that's positive and important. But again, it doesn't only happen in church or in the name of Christ. There are service organizations that abound in cultures around the world. In the United States, you can begin with service clubs and organizations, some of which are named after animals like lions and elks and moose and eagles. Okay, and others that have directionality and other kind of catchy titles, the Rotary, the Exchange, the March of Dimes, the Odd Fellows, Shriners, American Legion, Knights of Columbus, Hadassah, the list goes on and on. And for many decades, people in those kinds of groups have given their time, their treasure, and their effort to make sure to fund specific community needs. This is an amazing, sustained cultural phenomenon of being in service. It reminds me exactly of what we said earlier in this room about our help ministry through Cook's Night Out. The fact that for 26 months plus, we have been providing a hot meal to dozens of people during a pandemic and beyond. It doesn't matter how we serve, but Jesus is giving us a great example in the gospel today. And yes, it's 2022 now. We don't go around washing each other's feet. That's not a service that we need to focus on. But we can collect food and cook food and extend people and be, as Mark had said, a connection in our community. We can support other groups that collect eyeglasses, that clean up the park. Our own denomination has volunteers in mission trips around the world to where people are hurting. Places like Haiti and Puerto Rico and other places that have been besieged by natural disasters and otherwise. We have seen up close and personal and participated in missions of trips of individuals, youth, and their sponsors to Appalachia to spend a week in service of rebuilding and helping individuals who were without resources. And we've seen recently our own group here rebuilding, helping rebuild a home in the town of Poughkeepsie for a disabled veteran who needed that kind of support. This church, this local church, this cooperative parish that we sit in and worship, the examples of service abound here. It's an exemplary history that Christ calls us to continue. We must continue. There's a prayer that we often sing in this room, and we all know the theme behind it. The words are, "Make me a servant, humble and meek. Lord, let me lift up those who are weak. And may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant. Make me a servant. Make me a servant today." Hymn number 2176. We ask God's blessing on all those that serve others, all others that serve in this world, as Christ has taught us. Amen. Our hymn is, "We Will Glorify the King of Kings." It's "In the Faith We Sing," number 2087. Prayers for our parish leaders who this afternoon will be meeting with your new pastor, who will be taking over July 1st. And I wanted to thank Mark as lay leader, Dave as the chair of our SPR efforts, both locally and as a parish, for working with the district superintendent. So they may have some news to share in the short future. So let's all pray that God gives us a continuity of pastoral leadership, as I have been praying regularly. And I also wanted to thank God for the blessings that he's bestowed on my wife and I, who found ourselves last year in need of a smaller assignment, something that I could handle a little bit more physically well. And we also have some health concerns at our age that we're wrestling with. And even though it's sad to move on, I feel excited and blessed by being appointed the pastor of the Litchfield, Connecticut UMC, and I will take that responsibility in July as well. But I also wanted to thank everyone in all of our congregations for their love, for their Christian service, and remind them that even though from July going forward, I won't be your pastor, but I'll always be your friend. And that friendship is undying. So thank you for all. It's difficult for all of us to go through these transitions, and I know you've gone through them well before. And may God bless us all in this transition. Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Okay, all right. We'll continue with lifting our prayers to God, and I invite you to pray to the Lord. Let us pray. God of grace and mercy, we stand here in service to you. We are inspired by the life that our Savior Jesus Christ has led, and we follow his example and his teaching of being servants of the Lord for all that we need. Help us to do this with humility, with courage, and strength to offer the gifts and graces you have bestowed upon each and every one of them, on one of us, so that we may fulfill a need in others that we meet. Help us to follow Christ's command of loving one another as he has loved us. Thank you, God. We lift our prayers today to you, and especially this prayer that Christ has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's share the peace of the Lord with one another.
remember to be servants of God as Christ has served all of us as we accept today's offering. Lord of all, we thank you as we bring our humble gifts to you for the mission and ministry of your church in this community and the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
God bless everyone.
Yeah, you too.